This is George Merrick. We're here on a Sunday recording the new show, Doremi. And in my admittedly prejudiced opinion, it's a brilliant show.
I don't think you're in the least bit prejudiced.
No, fine. You are not either. I can see that, Adolf. Well, I'm in good company, it seems. I'm here with Betty Comden, Adolf Green, and Julie Stein. Julie Stein is one of our foremost young composers. May I call you young, Julie?
Oh, I love it. love it.
Well, he is young, and he is lively, and he's a stickler for perfectionist, as we have just learned. We've been here since 10 o'clock this morning, and we are far from through. And Betty Comden and Adolf Green are urbane, witty, charming lyricists.
Also young.
Yes.
Also young.
Young.
That, in their case, it doesn't need to be said.
Of course not.
But I resent that.
Yes, I resent it for you, Julie.
I who rolled Julie up the street in a baby carriage.
Julie, tell the audience something, tell us something about the origin of the show.
The first time I knew about Do Re Mi is when it was a little... What do we call it?
Novella.
Novella.
Novella. It was a book. That's
short,
a book.
Short
a
novel.
Book.
Short novel written by Gosson Kanin. And I thought it was very amusing, and I liked the character and the period. And I called Gosson Kanin. I phoned him, rather, and he told me he had just sold it to a movie company. And I forgot about it. But a movie came out which was supposedly be Do Re Mi, which wasn't Do Re Mi at all. They had bought the title Do Re Mi, and they made a completely other story.
I didn't know
that. Oh, yes. 20th Century Fox bought Do Re Mi, but they didn't make Do Re Mi, nor did they call it Do Re Mi. They made something else, had all to do with another subject matter. And so,
Julie, the truth is it was called The Birth of a Nation, and it made history.
Oh, very good. You see, Adolf.
With lyrics by Compton and Green, or without?
And D.W. Griffiths.
Go on.
And
don't mind the hecklers.
No, I've had them for years, really. Betty and Adolf have been heckling me for years. Anyhow, when it wasn't made, I went back to Gosson Kanin and asked him if he would be, if he would like to do a musical. And he said he didn't feel like directing any longer. He only wanted to write. I said, well, unless you direct this piece, we can't do this. If you want to direct and write it, fine. And so he decided to, and we started working on the show Do Re Mi.
Now, let me ask you something. When you, all three of you, when you start working, do you get the idea, the melodic idea first?
I would like to tell our audience one thing before you ask me about the melody. I want to tell you that one day I went into Lindy's and I saw Phil Silver sitting there, and I said, Phil, do you want to be in a show? He says, yes, what's the name of it? I said, Do Re Mi. He says, who's doing it? I said, I'm going to do it with Betty and Adolf and Gosson Kanin. He said, I'll be over tomorrow. So that's how we got Phil Silver's show, because I walked into Lindy's that
Even
day.
Even so, his history is made. And probably his pastrami sandwich was pretty good, and that's why he was in an agreeable mood. Now can I go back to
you
the question?
You can go back to anything.
All right. Now, how do songs get written? I think that's what our audience wants to know. Is the melodic idea come first? Do you write lyrics to order, or is it the other way, or is it a little of both?
Well, Betty, do you want to answer that a little bit?
It's always a little bit of all the processes. Actually, when you're writing for a book show, the songs usually come out of the situation and character, and from that you usually get ideas and titles and then start to write songs. But in addition to that, usually, Julie has some marvelous tunes, and then even though they have no titles, we then decide we're going to use them somehow. Like Just in Time, which was written for Bells Are Ringing, was a tune that Julie used to play at parties for a year as Dee Da Dum Da 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 Dee Da Dum. It was a big smash that way.
This one was Dee Da 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 Dum Dee Da Da Dee Da Da Da.
Yeah, until we got the lyric.
Well, I don't give too much of it away because we want them to buy the album.
You say, how does it come? I must say that working with Betty and Adolf is kind of Like you walk into your, it's kind of like working with a family. When I walk in, they understand my shorthand, but they have one
it's
thing.
It's a sixth sense. It's a
they have a thing. They know when they hear something, they say, "My God, write it down because I can never play it back the second time." But Betty has a wonderful memory. She retains something that I played the first time that I can't remember myself.
Well, Betty said something about a book show, and I think that needs a little explanation. You do write songs then, which fit the situation, or specifically, was the song Adventure written before or after you knew that Nancy Walker was going to be in the show?
That was written after.
Well, we were
after.
Hoping that Nancy
yeah, we
was going to be in the show.
Yeah, but we had the character. We had
the character had to have
the
that
wife.
Song.
Yeah.
I think we would have had Adventure whether
in
Nancy Walker in the show in any
we
case.
We were looking
I mean,
for a great second act number for them.
For the wife and the husband.
And something that would combine being both a highly comic song, we hoped, and also have real qualities of telling their love story while being funny.
David Merrick said, you know, the shows, are, musical shows, are really born in rehearsals. You start with an idea, but there's so much addition and changing and gestation going on during the rehearsal. Do you agree with that?
No, I don't. Well, partially I agree. A musical is, he's right to the extent that a musical comedy is never finished and written until it opens.
It's not born, it starts growing up in rehearsal. I mean, you start
well,
rehearsal
that's a better
with
way
a,
of putting
with
it.
A full score and a book, and then you begin.
And you have a you have a book and score, lyrics and music, that is either a healthy little boy or a patient, you know, and you have to be the doctor, sort of, as well as the patient yourself.
Well, specifically, how many songs did you actually write, Julie, for Doreen Me, and how many of them were actually used?
I wrote a lot of incidental music all through the show besides. I had about 900 sheets of scoring. You know, that's a lot of scoring paper. For the people listening in, that means 900 pages of manuscript that I personally wrote, that I wrote out for myself for the arrangers to arrange. But we have six songs that we wrote for this show. We added and subtracted. We have now six or seven. In fact, we may do a show with all the stuff that's left over.
You made your decision, obviously, on audience reaction.
No, a lot of it was length at the beginning. No. We just knew we were overlong, and we'd expressed too many things musically,
and it had to be cut down.
But then when you got to the tryouts, was there any surprise in audience reaction? In other words, did you know pretty well what songs would appeal?
You never know.
You never know. That's
really
the point I'm trying to bring
out. That's
experienced as you are, one never knows.
No, of course, whatever the sum is of your experience is obviously of enormous help, but those things function instinctively rather than as, I know this and we will do that.
I think David Merrick meant that what he meant was that a show is written and then it is made during rehearsal. For instance, speaking of scores, you know, in a comedy show, our stars are Phil Silvers and Nancy Walker, and our show has a comedy premise, as all the critics have hailed it as the funniest show in years. Well, in a funny show, in the first act, we have four ballads. It's quite unusual to have four.
Sure.
You don't get four ballads in South Pacific in the first act. Yeah. Here we have four ballads in the first act in Do Re Mi, you know, which is quite. You only had one ballad in Fair Lady. We have four ballads. I mean, it's funny.
Julie, that was good.
But still, the overwhelming, the impression of it is one of gaiety and fun.
Oh, gaiety and fun.
Well, I think it was a collective good thinking in all our parts. We knew we had Phil Silvers, and then we knew we had Nancy Walker. And we said, to offset that, this is our chance to have
two
lovely songs and two terrific voices. And I think we got them with Johnny Reardon and Nancy Duso.
I must say, we wrote for the two such voices and we got them. I mean, John Reardon and Nancy Duso, more than one can expect. I mean.
All right, I want to ask you one more question. That is, I want to ask Betty and Adolph. You stay out of
it,
Julie.
I'm out of it.
All right. You are noted as performers. In fact, I've seen you as performers. Do you ever get the itch and jump in there and do it better than the people in the show? And if so, what parts would you take?
Oh, well, I think being performers helps us in writing a great deal. And we know from having worked with performers and performing ourselves, you know, a lot about comedy material and how it will how it will feel to a performer who'll have to do it. And then, of course, we always have our big moment just the first day of rehearsal when Adolf and I perform the whole score. It isn't a question of better or not as good. It's just something
we enjoy doing. It isn't better. It's brilliant. I enjoyed that afternoon. Yes, I remember very
you.
Well.
Thank you.
Adolf, you want to add anything to it?
To the performing
Yes,
thing?
To the performing.
No, I would just repeat what Betty said. I think the thing that's good about performing, that our background, is just that we do have, I think, an instinct for what will work for people on the stage. And together with Julie, incidentally, one of the things we've done, we have written shows for Judy Holliday, for instance, and we wrote a lot of things for Peter Pan, for Mary Martin,
yes.
And now with Phil Silvers. All of us happen to know these people.
And Julie has the background also,
Julie has the background,
coached
so that
and worked with singers
we know,
and performers.
We have in mind what is going to work for them.
In other words, you know what's practical
well,
in the theater.
I think we've had probably more experience collectively than anyone else in the theater today, with the exception of Dick Rogers, because they have written for Rosalind Russell, they have worked with Jerome Robbins, we work with Mary Martin and Judy Holliday. I work for Ethel Merman. I coach people. They have a great understanding and appreciation of music besides their lyrics. Betty is a fine musician, and Adolf is one of the finest conductors of our time. You run out of a fella in your series. He conducts.
I'll talk to you later.
No,
after
seriously,
the session
his knowledge.
Adolf is fantastic.
I know that personally.
Yes.
Well, experience or no experience, I mean, the proof of the pudding is always in the enjoyment of the audience. And I think it was wonderful. I've been twice to the show to see for once a show in which you don't have to make any mental apologies, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
That the audience sits there and they're just having a wonderful time.
That doesn't mean you're playing down to anybody, which
Indeed
is the one
not.
Thing we all hate.
Well, I happen to believe in art that in the long run the audience is right. I'm extremely suspicious of any art which is only for the conoscente.
Right.
All right, thank you very much
for
being here. Julie Stein, Betty Compton, and Adolf Green. This is George Marek, and let's get back to work now.
Good.